And a voice came out of the throne, saying, Praise our God, all ye his servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Will you please rise as we go to our hymn, On Higher Ground? It's in your hymn book, 171, Higher Ground.
I'm resting on the upward way, new heights I gain every day. Still praying as I onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand, thy faith on heaven's table land. Feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright. But still I pray till end I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. I keep on
Please bow with me. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, you are the bright and morning star, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the author of all creation, as you reign only and supreme, and yet you are agape, the very meaning of love. The God who has loved us so much, so as to send your only Son to die for our salvation. You were in a garden. You stood beside Abraham. In a fiery furnace, you were there too, and along with Daniel, to quiet the fury of the hungry lions. You were the fire and the smoke that led the Israelites out of captivity. You were the food and the water that sustained them in the desert. You were there to watch your Son hang upon a Roman cross as the sin of the world, my sin, all of our sins, piled upon him, so much so that even you had to look away. Even in that, your love for us could not be extinguished as you wrote our names forever in the Lamb's Book of Life. There is nothing we can do to deserve your love for us. No work of art, no task complete to be deserving. We stand before you this morning humbled by your love for us. Complete in us the work of your desire. Mold us for service in your kingdom and use us to stand upon the rock of our salvation and never waver. Be with us, your servant, this morning, and take joy in our praise and our songs and our joy, for one day soon your Son, our Lord, will return. Make us fit and ready for the task at hand. For it's in the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Hymn number 110 in your red books, in the suite, By and By. 110.
Dwelling place there in the sweet. by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore. A melodious song of the blessed. And our spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for a blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. Of his love and the blessings that hallow our day. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
You may be seated as we go to our responsive reading this morning from Psalms 35, 1 and 2. O Lord, attack those who attack your people. Use your shields, both small and large.
Arise to help us.
Amen. A blessed reading of God's word. If you'll turn in your hymnals to for our praise song this morning to 487, when we all get to heaven. This is it's got a big lot of megabytes on it, so sometimes the words lag just a little bit. So.
Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace.
487.
In the mansion's pride and blessing, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory.
All right, and then we have our teens going to come up and do a special for us this morning.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Good job. All right, our memory verse this morning from 1 Corinthians 6:19. I know Polly's got most of it memorized. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? 1 Corinthians 6:19. Amen. And bless the reading of God's word. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see everyone this morning. It was a little bit cold, but not nearly as cold as it was last week coming over. And the sun's supposed to heat up today, and we're supposed to have a really, really beautiful day. I've been out working last week trying to get the ground ready for the building that's supposed to come in. It's supposed to come in at 6 weeks, like 3 weeks ago when I ordered it, or 2 weeks ago, and they called Friday and wanted to come next week, but I'm not ready yet, so I had to postpone it. But we're looking forward to that. Boy, what a blessing we got that tractor converted from 6 volt to 12 volts, and it just runs like a champ and starts, and it's like a completely new piece of equipment and that. So I'm glad for that. It's good to see all of you watching us from home, and it's good to see everyone here this morning on a bright sunny morning. I want to make sure that we have our announcements for this week. It's good. I'm glad that we see our services now back in the Titusville Herald. So I'm glad to see that. We have Bible study Wednesday at 7 o'clock. And I'm here for counseling. If you need counseling, you can give us a call at 967-3628. 967-3628. That's 814 area. And, you know, we do all kinds of counseling. I haven't had anybody that's ever come to me for counseling say that they didn't appreciate coming, so or want to come back. So if you have somebody or know somebody or are somebody that needs counseling for family matters or alcohol and drug or other things, please give us a call, and I'll get you into the schedule, I promise you. Next Sunday, we're going to have the birthday party for January, February, and March. For all the kids who have birthdays in January, February, and March, we'll have a potluck birthday party and lots of fun after church next week. I did get a letter from Mary this week, who said that she got a painting and she was happy about that. And I've got to get something off to Nora here pretty soon as well. But just really good to have people who watch us from home. They call me and talk to me and want to be part of the service here, part of our little congregation. And actually, with all the people that watch us, we're not probably a little congregation, but probably more than we know. So if you're out there and you watch us, I would appreciate some kind of note, a card, a letter, or something from you, letting me know. They can write Community Bible Church, Post Office Box 41 in Titusville, 16354, I will get it. I said I'm still looking for a baseball coach or somebody that will help me with it. When I do T-ball or work with the kids, I'd love to get somebody to come out here and do that and make sure that you know the time is racing by. It's March already, right? It's March already. So that means Christmas was 3 months ago, December. Well, not quite fully 3 months ago, but my goodness, that seemed just like yesterday, right? And so time is really flying by, and camp's just around the corner, because we're just talking about spring break ending and getting the kids ready for camp here right after school's out. So, if you want to send a kid to camp, please send us some money, and we'll put that aside for kids to go to camp. All right, and then the next thing I wanted to talk about is this coronavirus going on around. One of the things I really wonder, and it really makes me think a lot about, is this thing, how it has spread around the world so quickly, and I think there's almost no place right now that's untouched by it. We have, like what I heard yesterday, 400 cases. It's probably 600 or close to that now. A lot of those I know from offshore, but it showed a map of the states, and a lot of the states are there. And, you know, it really, when I see these things, it really brings me back to prophecy in the Bible that tells us that these are the kind of things that are going to happen in the last day. And you can't help but wonder, God, is God is there. We're here because we know God is there. And I believe that God is looking down. I'm not sure that I believe that God created the coronavirus for us. But I'm certainly sure that God is watching to see, is this the thing that's going to get people back to church? Is this the thing that's going to get people to, you know, repent and change their life and want to be close to Jesus Christ? Because, you know, we've had the SARS outbreak. We've had several different. We've had, you know, the swine flu, the SARS. We've had the Ebola. We've had several different things going on, and now this is bigger than some of the other things that have happened, the bird flu and some of these other things. And, you know, if you're God, thinking about myself, if I'm God looking down and saying, man, we've had tornadoes and hurricanes and all these things, and if that doesn't get them back to church, nothing's going to. And you have to wonder if this should bring us back to the Lord and bring us back. But there's going to be a time, you know, is this the one? Is this the thing that God looks down and said, you know, I've given them everything reasonable. Now it's time to send the real one. And because that's what's going to happen, and people don't realize that, but that's what's going to happen, you know. And God's going to get impatient with the fact that we just don't respect Him anymore, and we think that we can do it without Him. You know, fortunately, the death toll with this is quite low, but very sadly, the death toll with this is quite high in the nursing homes for elderly people, which is really sad. So we want to keep keep those people on our prayers, but even more so in our prayers, we should be praying that people come back to the Lord, people come back to the house of God, and people start to worship again. We have the I guess now it is declared to be 4 tornadoes that hit in Tennessee. One of them is a EMF-4. Was almost the worst possible one, and did a lot of damage, and quite a bit of life was lost in Tennessee. And so we want to keep those people in prayer as well. But we also want to praise God for all of those things that are a blessing in our life, that God has done, to restore a blessing to us. And I know it truly was a blessing. I had to get railroad ties to put out around here, and I kind of was really worried about, the getting railroad ties out here, because they're pretty heavy, and I wasn't sure that I could do much with my arm. But then Polly came out and helped, and then Gene came out a little bit later, and he helped, and we had the tractor back. That tractor came back on the day that we needed it, and I could roll them on the tractor, and we still had to pick them up, move them around, and muscle them around, But God has put me in a position where my arm is stronger than I thought it was. I'm not back to normal, but I'm still not going to let things slow me down. So if you're waiting at home, for things to slow me down, don't wait, because they're not. So anybody else have a blessing? And I'll give another one. On the way to church this morning, I hit a dip in the road, and there was a whole bunch of deer standing right in the middle of the road, and there wasn't anything I could do, because they were, I came over the little dip, and they were right there in the bottom in the dip all over the road, and I had to do this and do this, and somehow I managed to thread my car right through without hitting any of them, and fortunately none of them moved. The last time I hit a deer, he went across and then came back. If he'd just kept going, I'd have been fine. But he decided that, or she decided she was going to come back, and that's what got her. But this time, on a Sunday morning. So anybody else this morning, have a praise. God working wonderful, wonderful things in your life. Yes, Charlie. But Charlie's back at church, yes. That's a praise, too. Anyone else this morning? Marietta is here, and it's good to see her. And I know I got smiles from Mom and Brother and that, so that's good. And everyone else around the room, too. Everyone's smiling. All right. Anyone else have a praise this morning? God working miracles and wonderful, wonderful things in your life. Spring's coming. I looked on the weather forecast, and I'm not sure what day it was, because we're supposed to get a little bit of rain this week, or maybe a lot of rain, I don't know, but I looked on the forecast, and out there one day, it said it was going to be 60 degrees, so that's coming, right, and it's coming faster than we think, so, yes. For the sunshine, isn't it wonderful? When we go so long without the sun, our vitamin D levels get down. We get depressed. It's we really need to be taking vitamin D in this area, but it's wonderful to see the sun. And I even included that in my sermon, because the sun can make me get out and want to just do all kinds of things, and work around. Anyone else this morning have a praise? God working wonderful things in your lives. How about prayer requests this morning? Yes, Charlie. I'm sorry?
Two of my teachers have to get surgery.
Okay, for Charlie's teachers. Abby. Pardon? Yes. And I appreciate that for my mother. And surprisingly, it's her birthday today. So, it's her birthday. She doesn't want me to tell anybody her age, but it's up there. But it's her birthday today. Anyone else this morning have a prayer request? Yes, Linda.
Caleb.
Caleb, yes. Yes, we've been having that. We've got several kids down with the flu, and it was Abby's week last week, and Caleb got it. Now he's out this week, and so And then the kids have off Friday, right? So we need to pray for parents who are going to have kids on Friday and not know what to do with them. Anyone else this morning?
Unsaved loved
ones. Unsaved, yes. Anyone else this morning? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for being the God that's always there. We thank you for always answering our prayers. And we thank you for your hand being stretched out for us even before we know or need it. I think about this morning, and if your hand wasn't there, it could have been a completely different episode. But I thank you so much for watching over us and taking care of us and being such a big part of our lives. Lord, we ask you to continue to be with those who are struggling with the coronavirus and those who are scared to death. Lord, we pray that this will bring people closer to you. And I know that it, in many places it's got to be sad to be looking down and see that people are struggling and it doesn't cause them to turn to prayer. It doesn't cause them to return to the church. And that truly is sad. We pray that those conditions will change. But we know that your son soon will come and in a cloud and will take us from this place. And then things like the coronavirus will be even worse. Lord, we ask you to be with the teachers that are ill this morning or need surgery, rather. Be with my mother, Elizabeth, and we ask you to also be with all of those who watch us from TV, Nora and Mary and all the rest of our people that watch us. We ask you to be with Caleb and the other kids who are out sick this morning as well. And we ask you to be with all of our unsaved loved ones. Lord, help us to learn as we go through this book of Romans, to learn how to use the Roman road, how to have the strength and the faith and the courage to open our mouths to tell other people that I'm a Christian and I believe in Jesus Christ and I'm going to heaven and I'm safe, I'm secure, I'm happy with my life. Help us to get our children to when they sit in the cafeteria, to bow their heads and say grace. I think of Eric, who is our autistic child who goes to school up in Erie, and parents got a telephone call saying that he wouldn't eat. And so the parents said, "Do you pray?" "Oh, no, we don't do that." And they said, "Well, pray, and he'll eat." And they did. And lo and behold, Eric began eating at school. I thank you for the lessons that we learn, that we need to learn. Lord, I ask you to be with all of those who are standing on the wall, all of those in the military, in each and every branch that are watching over this country to keep us safe and secure, to be with their families who wait for them to return. Lord, I ask you to be with all the policemen and firemen and be with their families who send them out into an ever-increasingly dangerous world, praying and waiting for them to come home. Lord, I just ask you to continue to be with this church. Help us to grow and to reach the people around us, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ so that people will know that there is something beyond this world, and that they need to find a Savior. We ask all these things. In the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. 305 in your hymnal, if you have it. 305 in this sweet hour of prayer.
Just know and see.
says, and gladly take my station there, and wait for
continue going through the book of Romans. We're all the way up to chapter 12. And so if you have your Bibles, turn with them to Romans chapter 12, verses 9 through 21. We'll finish the 12th chapter today. Let love be without deception. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love, in honor preferring one another. Don't be lazy in showing your devotion. Use your energy to serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. Share what you have with God's people who are in need, and be hospitable. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one towards another. Mind not high and lofty things. Don't be arrogant, but be friendly to humble people of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. Don't pay people back with evil for the evil they do to you. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Paul is talking about relationships. First, last week was our relationship to God and Christ, and now he's going to talk about our relationship to other believers and our relationship to the outside world, and we'll begin with our relationship to other believers. Love, let love be without deception. This is without hypocrisy. Don't pat another believer on the back and say something that you don't mean. Let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor that which is evil means to express your hatred of that which is evil. When you find something wrong, stand up for the truth. We need men and women with backbone to express their hatred for that which is evil. Cleave means to stick like adhesive tape, to be welded or cemented together with the good things. The believer should always be identified with good things rather than shady or questionable practices. Be kindly affectionate one towards another with brotherly love, in honor, preferring one another. This is one of those places in Scripture where I believe that way too many religious people have taken this instruction way too far in the wrong direction. Paul isn't saying here to love the world or to be kind to the world. The world hates Christians and will only take advantage of a Christian if the Christian allows. But Paul is speaking about our behavior to love and be kind to one another. one another Christians. Paul tells us that we as Christians must have a code of honor and be aglow with the Spirit of God. We are to have a zeal for the things of God, love the brethren in the faith as though they were brethren in blood. For example, three men are sitting together. Two of the men are identical twins. One twin is a Christian and the other is not. Sitting with these men is a believer from Africa. His culture, his background, and language are all different. The color of his skin is different, but he knows the Lord as Savior. The Christian twin is actually closer to the man from Africa than he is to his own twin brother. You ought to be nicer to your fellow believer because you are both part of the same body. The twin that is not a Christian believer, sadly, is not part of the body of believers. You will live with your brothers and sisters in Christ in heaven for all eternity. Unless your twin brother or family member becomes born again and repents of his or her sin and accepts Jesus Christ as Lord, you will watch them be waved and off into the lake of fire for all eternity with Satan and every other bad and evil thing in the world. Not because God is a bad person, but because God has given them many opportunities to make the correct choice. And they have time after time after time and time again refused to make the right choice, which is Jesus Christ. Since you will live with your brothers and sisters in Christ throughout eternity, you had better start getting along with them right here and now. The fact of the matter is that as a believer, our eternity really has already begun. It began at the moment we accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of our lives. We switched our earthly family for our heavenly family. I wish the people would really understand this switch that has taken place for the believers in Christ. Then maybe more believers would earnestly work on family members to become born again. And I've been here many a time with people who I've led to the Lord and talked to who just seem to be scared to death to talk to other family members about Jesus Christ, and will go off with them and have a beer and do other things, you know, but never live the Christian life and never bring them. And it's going to be a sad day when Jesus comes. Be not slothful in business. Has nothing to do really with business. It actually means not to be a lazy person. We are to approach everything with joy and excitement. As I said before, I had to do a lot of work out on the property this week. My arm is still recovering and my back and knees provide me with enough pain, even on a good day, to have an excuse to stay in bed. But the sun came out. And for a little while it came out anyway, and I became excited to get on the list of jobs that need to be done around here. I missed doing anything last year, so now my job list is three times longer than it should be. I approach my tasks with joy and excitement. I am working for Christ, my Lord, and I am working for the body of believers. What can possibly be more wonderful than that? That when we do the things that we do them for the Lord and the people that we do them for. Nothing can be more wonderful, more exciting than that. So don't, Paul says, not to be a lazy person. Paul tells us to be aglow with the Spirit, suggesting that our zeal and enthusiasm should be under the control of the Holy Spirit, serving the Lord. Our whole being and makeup should point every believer towards this focal point. We are to rejoice in hope, patient in tribulation, which means to be patient with the world who will come against you. Continuing instant in prayer, distributing to the necessity of saints. Saints means to other believers, always given to one another. Hospitality, prayer, rejoice, being concerned about them and wanting to pray for other peoples. We shouldn't be lazy in those things. We are to be a joy to one another. We should always recognize that the world is a very inhospitable place for every believer, and that we believers will only find hospitality with one another. To the rest of the world, we are crazy and insane and all kinds of other things, and we are fodder to be killed all the day long. We just did this verse, but listen to it again.
As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. We should rejoice in hope, should be the fate of the believer. The circumstances of the believer may not warrant rejoicing. The opposite may be true. But the believer sees and knows the future, and in hope projects himself into more favorable circumstances. We should know we have already won. We are victorious already with our life. This verse always makes me think about a brother down in the South years ago. In a church service, people were raising their hands to give their favorite scripture verses. This one brave soul stood up and said that his favorite verse was, it came to pass. Everyone looked puzzled. The preacher stood up and said, brother, how in the world can it came to pass be your favorite verse in the Bible? The answer was quite simple. He said, when I have trouble and when I have problems, I like to read that verse, it came to pass. And when I read that, I know that my troubles or my problems has come to pass. They haven't come to stay. This believer, this brother, was always looking for a new day out there. And that is what Paul has in mind when he says, rejoice in hope. By the way, it came to pass is quoted over 800 times throughout the Bible. All our troubles came upon us. To pass, not to stay. We must always find ourselves close to our Lord and our God by being constant in prayer. You can never be alone when you are in prayer. Distributing to the necessity of saints. God expects us to share what he has given to us with fellow believers who are in need. We are to be given in hospitality means actually to pursue hospitality, not be passive in that. That is we are to seek out other believers to whom we can extend hospitality. There may be a person in your neighborhood or even in your church or in your school who is an introvert and retiring and yet longs for Christian fellowship. We are to look that person up and extend our fellowship to him or her. Very sadly, someone recently, a wonderful Christian lady, told me that she was missing Christian fellowship, so she joined a local church. That was 18 months ago, and she's still looking for someone to come and fellowship with her. And it has not happened yet. And I can tell you, it becomes a very lonely experience to be a Christian and not be connected to the body and receive the fellowship of the believers. We as believers are instructed that it is our duty to reach out in love to other believers. Bless them which persecute you seems to be a needless injunction for believers. Surely one believer would not persecute another, would he? It is difficult to bless a man who is kicking you, but we are to bless and curse not. Rejoice that with them that do rejoice. The world's motto is, laugh, and the world laughs with you. Weep, and you weep alone. But that is not true of the believer. We are to enter into the joy and sorrow of other believers and weep with those who weep and laugh with those who laugh. Be of the same mind, one towards another. Doesn't mean uniformity of thought, but that we are to have the mind of Christ. Believers ought to enter emotionally into the lives of other believers. I think that is something that makes genuine Christians so wonderful. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Paul said to the Philippians, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What kind of mind did Christ have? He had a humble mind. Be not wise in your own conceits. In other words, stop being wise in your own opinion. Solomon, who was a man with wisdom from God, gave a very interesting injunction. He said, seest thou a man wise in his own conceit? There is more hope of a fool than in him. Paul now takes us to the relationship of unbelievers. You and I live in a world of unbelievers. What is to be our relationship with them? Paul says, recompense to no man evil for evil. The suggestion is that the believer should expect evil. We should expect evil. I have people telling me this all the time. Why in the world did that happen to me? Is it because we're Christians? And we should expect evil. And we should expect evil at the hands of the world. Because that's what the world and all its people do. However, we are not to strike back with evil. This does not mean that as a believer we are to just give up and accept defeat. We are not required to be pacifists either. I have had evil come against me on many occasions, and I believe that God puts me in those positions because he knows I will stand up and I will fight. I will stand up and expose that evil. And I feel this way because I believe that if I do not stand up, evil gets stronger and will attack the next believer with more vengeance. And that blood will be on my hands. I have never attempted to win by lying or stealing or cheating. I will never win against evil by using evil. I am happy in my victories because they are God's victories. I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me, Paul tells us in Philippians. And I am a dismal failure at accomplishing anything by evil means. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. There is nothing that can hurt the cause of Christ more than a dishonest Christian. The non-Christian is not concerned about the doctrinal beliefs you hold. However, he does want to know if you are truthful or not. He does want to know if you pay your honest debts. You are a person that a man can depend upon, or are you a man that a person can depend upon? Providing things honest in the sight of all men. Some years ago in Memphis, Tennessee, a Christian was handing out tracts. And he handed this man out a tract. And the man said, "What is this?" And the Christian replied, "It's a tract, and I would like for you to read it." The man replied, "I don't read. But I will tell you what I will do," said the man. "I will watch your tracts. The world is watching the tracts that you make, not the tracts you give out. Don't misunderstand me. Giving out gospel tracts is important. But you must have a life that will back those tracts up when you give them out. And this includes the giving of advice and instruction as well. If it is possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably." I love this because there are people that you just cannot get along with. They don't let you get along with them. A dear lady who lived alone, a wonderful Christian, called me one day in deep concerns because she had a neighbor whom she couldn't get along with. And it bothered her greatly. And she wondered if I would come and talk with this dear neighbor. She wanted to be in a position where she could share the word with her and at least have a fence neighbor to talk to. So she asked me to come over and talk with a neighbor. As I was driving out there, I was thinking that since the lady that asked me to come out had been away for a long time and living alone, that maybe there was something that she might be a little bit difficult herself. So I went to the neighbor and talked with her. Well, the neighbor told me what she thought of me, as well as the dear lady and everything else nasty in the world, and it wasn't kind. So I went back to this wonderful Christian and said, "I don't think you need to worry anymore if you can't get along with her. Nobody can get along with that woman. The Bible says, as much as lieth in you. It doesn't say you have to get along with her. Just do the best that you can." Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give peace unto wrath. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord." Therefore, if thy enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. This is one of the greatest principles you will find in the Word of God. Yet it is the most difficult thing for a child of God to do. Again, as a Christian, Paul is not talking against going to the courts or to the police or to any other lawful authority. He is talking about avenging and vengeance, which is you in your own person inflicting harm upon someone who did something harmful to you. We tell this to the kids all the time. Two wrongs don't make a right. If Jimmy hit you, it doesn't make it right to hit Jimmy back. There is nothing in the Bible against you coming to the youth leader and telling her that Jimmy is hitting you and is hitting other kids in the playground. We find it difficult not to hit back, but the minute you and I take the matter into our own hands and attempt to work the thing out by hitting back as hard as we can, we have taken the matter out of God's control, and we are no longer walking by faith. We see a lot of vengeance movies these days where the victim's husband or girlfriend or boyfriend rather or father takes the whole gang on to get even. We should never be about getting even. And I don't know if it's even possible ever to get even with someone else who has done you wrong. If Jimmy hits you in the playground, how does it make you even if you hit Jimmy back? Or as we see sometimes around here, you hit someone else instead of Jimmy because now you are afraid of Jimmy. And so you go and instead of hitting Jimmy, you go and hit Sally instead. After Jimmy hits you, you have a ruse someplace. That's one thing. But after you hit Jimmy or Sally, now you still have a bruise spot plus bruised knuckles to go with it. That's two things. And having two things against Jimmy's one thing doesn't sound like even to me. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. In other words, stop being overcome of evil. Overcome evil by means of being good. As the believer walks through this evil world with its satanic system, he cannot fight it. We cannot. It's not possible for us to fight it. That's why we have a God. That's why we have a Lord. And that's why we have a Holy Spirit. If you attempt to fight this satanic system, it will beat you. You cannot adopt the same worldly tactics of hate and revenge that you would have to adopt in order to win. If you do, you can be assured of defeat. Overcome evil with good, Paul says. God has given the believer the good, which is the Holy Spirit. We are to walk in the Spirit. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh, Paul tells us in Galatians. Paul goes on to say, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. My hymn of dedication this morning is He Ran to Me. It's a new song. I hope you will enjoy it.
I knew that.
Saw God run is in the parable. We saw God running to accept him. That's the God we have, who is always there with open arms. Revelation tells us that Jesus stands at the door and knocks. We have all the opportunity in the world to be born again, to be saved, if we'll only accept Jesus into our life. Will my ushers please come forward for our tithes and offering? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the many, many blessings. And we ask you, Lord, to go with us as we complete our service here. To be with us and continue our relationship with you. Keep the door open so that we can constantly come and talk with you. To help us to be with you as we walk in the garden. And you walk with us and you talk with us. And you let us know that we are never, never alone. You are always there. Be with us and guide us. Help us to be the Christian people that we need to be. Watch over our comings and our goings. Bless the work that we do. Keep your hand upon us and our homes and our cars and our finances and our work and our school and all the things that we must do this week, and bring us back to this house. Give us the opportunity to read our Bibles this week, to come to Bible study, to share the gospel with somebody, to let somebody know, I'm born again. My security, I'm secure. My future is secure. I'm going to heaven. I'm not worried about coronavirus or any other thing. I have a Lord and a God. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Fast from and through, no, he will.
so all the world can see. God will be there, watching from above. Go now in peace, in faith.
It's supposed to be a beautiful day. Please have a wonderful rest of the day. God bless you, and you may be dismissed.